Hello friends, I'm Katrinah, and in this video I'm going to show you how to create a stylish e-commerce WordPress website by Angie Makes. This video is sponsored by Creative Market, so thank you Creative Market for your support in helping me to create these free WordPress training videos on YouTube. If you're not familiar with Creative Market is a platform for handmade designs from independent creators around the world, and on their site you'll find all kinds of really cool design assets like fonts, themes, graphics, and more that will help your website look more professional. So be sure to check them out at creativemarket.com. In this video, I'm really excited to share with you one of the featured bundles that is currently being offered at Creative Market. It's a WordPress bundle and includes 12 themes essentially for the price of one theme. So this provides a really great value if you're looking for a WordPress theme. So in this video, I'm going to be creating an e-commerce website using one of those 12 themes that are included in the WordPress bundle. So let's take a quick look at this e-commerce WordPress website we're going to be creating in this video. So here we are on the homepage of the e-commerce website we'll be creating in this video. And at the top, as expected, we have our header section, which includes the website title or logo, as well as a tagline. And on the right-hand side, we'll have these social media icons. This particular design comes with two menu navigation areas. So we'll have a top menu as well as a primary menu. And one cool thing that I really like about this design is that it comes with a built-in call to action right at the top of the header. So this is a great place to invite your visitors to sign up for your email list, which is a really good way to start capturing leads directly as soon as your visitors arrive on your page. So underneath the header section, we'll have this slider. In this particular demo, I'm going to be featuring a static image, but I will show you how to create the slider effect with revolving images. Underneath the slider, we'll have these other images here, each of which will lead to a different section or page within your website. Then we'll have this quote, or you can add a tagline or something, some sentence about your online business, letting your visitors know what your website is all about. Underneath that, we'll have our featured products. This is an e-commerce website, so it's always a good idea to feature your featured products on the homepage. Then underneath that, we'll have our footer section. And in this particular demo, I'm going to be featuring my Instagram photos, an email opt-in form, and some quick links. However, this particular section is completely customizable, so I'll be showing you how you can add custom content if you prefer other content down here instead. Okay, so this is what the homepage looks like. Let's take a look at some of the internal pages within the website, starting with the About page. So the About page is one of the most frequently visited pages on all websites, so it's always a good idea to include an About page. So here I'm just going to create a pretty simple About page with a call to action, which when we click on this, it will lead to a contact page on the site, so your visitors can easily contact you from within your website. Pretty cool. Okay, then we'll have a cart page, so your customers, when they add stuff to the cart, they have a quick link that they can check out their cart. Then we have the shop page. I'm going to click on that. And here we'll have the display of all the products that you're offering on your website. Now, taking a look at one of the product individual pages, I'm going to click on this one right here. We'll see that you'll have the image of the product on the left-hand side, the title, the price, a short description, an add to cart button, and then we'll have these social sharing features right here. So anyone who may want to share this product with their friends or via social media, they can easily share via these buttons right here. Then down below, we'll have our longer product description and some reviews, and then we'll also add some related products. Having related products is a great way to increase your sales on your website, because if someone's interested in this, they may be interested in this stuff as well. So I'll show you how to add this in this video also. Okay, taking a look at the classes page, if you're a coach or consultant and you have a variety of different services that you want to bundle and package up, I'll be showing you how to create a customized pricing table, which when we click on any one of these different packages here, it will go to PayPal or whatever link you want it to go to. In this case, I have it set up to go to my PayPal so someone can purchase that custom package. And then last but not least, here at the top, we have our blog. This is one of my favorite things about this particular design, the Meadowbrook theme by Angie Makes. With this theme, it comes with a variety of different blog styles, and you can also customize a blog archive page if you don't see a style that you like. So in this particular case, I've customized a blog archive page to include a filter at the top, which makes it really easy to find blog content and posts within your blog. And I really like this Pinterest style design here on the blog archive page with all these really cool images that are associated with each post. So we're going to be creating this customized blog style as well within this video. So this is where we're headed toward in this video. We're going to be creating a e-commerce website using the Meadowbrook theme by Angie Makes, which is available within the WordPress bundle at Creative Market. This is a mobile-friendly design and theme, and that means it will look really nice on any kind of device, whether a smartphone, a tablet, desktop, laptop. And as a demo of the responsiveness of this theme, when I come to the bottom right-hand corner and I reduce the screen size to replicate a smartphone view, we'll see all the various images stack up really nicely, one on top of the other, so we can still see them really well within a smartphone version of the website. Now at the top, I do want to point out with this theme, note that the primary menu is displaying. However, that top menu is not displaying on a mobile device. So that's just something to keep in mind. However, that is why I added this extra quick link down below. So when we come to the mobile view right here, note that you can add whatever menu links you'd like here in the menu item down below. I could add my blog, I could add the cart page, it's right there. The about page is right there. So it is still navigable here in the footer section. Aside from the top menu not displaying in the mobile view, which we can correct by adding any kind of items in the footer, or of course, you can simply use this primary menu and not use this top menu altogether if you prefer, and I will show you how to do that in this video. I really like this theme. It has a really clean design and has a really strong emphasis on photos, which is really important for an e-commerce website. Also, I really love the blog that can be customized, especially with these filters and the Pinterest style layout. So this is where we're headed toward in this video. We're going to be creating this e-commerce website using the Meadowbrook theme by Angie Makes. Let's get started. So to create this website, we need a few things. Number one, we need a domain name, and number two, we need web hosting. In this video, I'm going to be using Hostgator.com for both the domain name as well as the web hosting. So here we are on Hostgator.com. First up, we need to click on this yellow button in the middle that says Get Started Now. Once you click on Get Started Now, then you'll arrive on this page where you can choose the web hosting plan that you would like. So when I scroll down, for example, we see that there's three different plans to choose from: Hatchling Plan, Baby Plan, and a Business Plan. If you're just getting started with your website, most likely you can use the Hatchling Plan, and that should be sufficient. So to keep within my budget for this demo purpose, I'm only going to be hosting one demo website using the Hatchling plan. So I'm going to click on sign up now for the Hatchling plan. Then I'll arrive on this page and I need to register my new domain name. So right in this box, I'm going to add my new domain name. And once you have the domain name available, then you want to just scroll down to the bottom. Here we see there's domain privacy protection as an option. I always get this because basically what this does is it prevents all of your information, like your email address, your phone number, your address, things like that. It prevents that and hides that from being included in an online database related to your website. So I always think it's a good idea to invest in this, but it's up to you. If you'd like to save some money, then of course you can uncheck it. So decide whatever works best for you, check it or uncheck it, and then we'll move forward. And here we have choose a hosting plan. So we've already chosen the Hatchling plan. I'm going to choose 6 months at a time because that is the best value with the coupon I'm going to share with you in just a moment. Then you add your username, your security PIN, enter your billing info. Then you want to scroll down and we have some more options. These are all optional, so read through these if you'd like. I'm not going to order these, however, so I'm going to uncheck them. And then down below here, we see that I have a enter a coupon code. So the coupon code by default is this one right here, but I have a special coupon code, which you will give you more money off, more of a discount. So it's always good. Everyone always loves to save more money. So I'm going to add that one right here. It's WP coupon 25. We can see we're going from $58 for 6 months of web hosting to, voila, when I click on validate, it goes down to $49. So if you'd like to get an extra amount off of your order, feel free to use my coupon code WPCoupon25. Now, if you don't want to sign up for 6 months at a time, I have another coupon that will give you more of a value for, this is the best coupon for 1 month, for example. So when I come down here, click on billing cycle, 1 month only, so we're going month to month. Then I scroll down to the coupon code. The best coupon when you're signing up for 1 month at a time is 1 month bonus. So I'm going to pop in 1 month bonus coupon code there and click on validate. And now we can see that my total is under $13. Super cool. So choose the one that works best for you, either WP coupon 25 or 1 month bonus. And I do want to note that I do receive a small referral when you use either of my coupons. And thank you so much for your support in helping me to continue to create free WordPress training videos. Okay, so once you have all of that set, you want to review the details of your order, scroll to the bottom, click on this button here that says you have read the terms of service after you've read them, of course, and then click on this yellow button that says check out now. So once you click on create your account, you'll get this page, which will thank you for your order and will tell you to go check your email for information related to logging into your web hosting account. So I'm going to go check out my email. And here we see on my email account, here's the email from Hostgator with my account info. So I'm going to click this email to open it. And I want to point out two things. Number one, the first link that they'll share with you in the email is the billing system link. And then right below that, you'll see that there's a link for your control panel with your username and a temporary password. So I'm going to copy this password here, the temporary password, and to log into your control panel, you'll use this link. So I'm going to click on this link here, and then here is my username. You want to type in your username, and then you want to add your password right here as well. Once you have that set up, you want to click on login to log into the control panel of your web hosting account. So here we are in the control panel of our Hostgator account. To install WordPress, which is step number two, we need to scroll down to the bottom, and here where it says services, software and services, we want to click on this button here that says quick install. Once we click on quick install, then we want to go to the left-hand side, and here where it says WordPress, we want to click on WordPress. Once we click on WordPress, then we'll see this install WordPress for free section, and then we want to click on this button that says install WordPress. And then here we want to fill out the form to get started with our install. So you just want to choose which website you need right here. And once you filled out the form, then you can click on this button here to install WordPress. Once your WordPress installation is complete, you'll get a message at the top here that says your install is complete. Click here to view your notifications, and you can also view your credentials. So then I'm just going to click on this little caret here to view my credentials, and here we can see I can go directly to the admin area by clicking on this link here, and here's my username and my password. So you just want to copy your password, highlight and copy it, click on this link, and then you can log in to your new WordPress website. So here we are on the WordPress dashboard. This is the first thing you'll see when you log in to your WordPress website. And here at the top, we'll have our welcome message that says, welcome to WordPress, with a number of links to get started. I'm going to be covering these links later on in the video, so I'm not going to go over these now. Instead, I'm going to hide this message altogether by dismissing it by clicking on this dismiss link right here in the top right-hand corner. Then we'll see all the other sections that are available on the dashboard. The cool thing about the dashboard is that you can move this stuff around by simply dragging the columns over left or right so that you can customize this how you would like to see it. Also, if you'd like to hide these sections altogether, you can do so by clicking on Screen Options, and then you can uncheck each of these boxes here, and that will hide all of these sections. I'm going to keep all these sections, though, with the exception of the welcome message, so I'll just click on all these one more time. Then I'm going to close or collapse this Screen Options menu by clicking on Screen Options. Okay, so let's take a look at the website right out of the box when we first install WordPress. To check out the site, go up to the top left-hand corner, hover over your website name, and click on Visit Site. Here we'll see this is the theme that comes with your WordPress installation. This is the 2015 WordPress theme, and we can see it looks very minimalist. I do have another video related to this particular theme if you'd like to create a website with this theme. But of course, in this video tutorial, we're going to be creating a website using the Meadowbrook theme by Angie Makes, which is available at Creative Market. So hopping over to the finished site, this is where we're headed toward in this video tutorial. By the end of the video tutorial, your website should look something like this. So the first step in order to create this website, of course, is we need to change our theme to the Meadowbrook theme by Angie Makes. So going back to our dashboard, I'm going to scroll down to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Themes. Here we can see on the left-hand side, the active theme is a 2015 theme, and on the right-hand side, we can add a new theme by clicking on this plus sign. However, before we can add the new theme, of course, we need to download the theme from Creative Market. So I'm going to head on over to creativemarket.com where I can find this really cool WordPress bundle. As we can see here, we can buy this for $39, but the cool thing about this is it offers a $633 value because we're not just getting one theme, we're getting all of these themes in one bundle, which is really awesome. And here on the left-hand side, here we can see the Meadowbrook theme is one of the many themes available within this bundle. So I'm just going to go through the process to buy this, and I'll see you on the other side once I've logged into my account and I've purchased this really awesome WordPress bundle. So here I am on creativemarket.com. I've logged into my account and I've purchased the WordPress bundle. So to download the bundle, or specifically to download the Meadowbrook theme by Angie Makes, up on the right hand side, I'm going to hover over my account name and go down to purchases and click on purchases. Here on the purchases page, we'll see all the purchases that I've made at Creative Market. And when I scroll down to the bottom, we'll see here is the Meadowbrook theme, Meadowbrook, the modern WordPress theme by Angie Makes websites. So cool. So on the right hand side, I'm going to download it by clicking on this download button right here to download the Meadowbrook theme. Once the Meadowbrook theme has been downloaded to our desktop, next up we can unzip the file. So on the right hand side, I'm just going to double click on this file right here to unzip it. And you may be using a different software. I'm on a Mac, so I'm using the Unarchiver software, which is built into my Mac and it helps to unpack the zip file. But whatever you're on, just double click on this zip file right here, and whatever system your computer is using, you can unzip the file. So I'm going to click on Extract here, which unzips all the file within the zip file. And now I have this folder on my desktop, which when I double click on this, we can see all the files that are included within the zipped version. And specifically when I click on theme, here we'll see this is the actual zip file that we need. So if you try and upload the entire bundled zip file, that's not gonna work. You really need to unzip it first, then you need to find the zip file within the theme folder. Okay, so now we're ready. Let's go back to our dashboard, specifically to the themes file, themes page, I should say. And here on the right-hand side, I'm gonna click on Add New Theme. And then at the top, I'm gonna click on Upload Theme and choose File. Then I'm gonna scroll down to the Meadowbrook folder right here, which we just unzipped. I'm gonna click on that. Then I'm going to click on theme, and here we go. Here is a zip file. So I'm going to highlight that and click on open to open and install this new theme. Last up, I need to click on the install button. Okay, and once the theme has been successfully installed, I can activate it by clicking on activate. So once the theme has been installed and activated, you'll automatically get this message at the top that says this theme recommends the following plugins. So we need to begin installing the plugins by clicking on this link that says begin installing plugins. Then I want to click on this box to check all of these various plugins, and I'm going to bulk action this by clicking on bulk actions, clicking on install, and then clicking on apply. Okay, so now we're good to go. All the plugins have been installed and activated successfully. Great. So now let's take a look at our website by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. So here we are on the new homepage of our WordPress website, and we can see we're moving in the right direction. Of course, we've got lots to do because once again, this is where we're headed. This is the end result where we're headed toward. So one of the really cool things about this theme is that the developer was kind enough to add an XML file within the theme package, which will help to speed up the customization of our website. So let's go back and add a WordPress tool that enables us to import that XML content. So going back to my dashboard, I'm going to click on dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to tools, hover over tools, and click on import. The one that I want to install is the WordPress one, which, as it notes, this allows us to install the WordPress importer to import posts and categories and tags from a WordPress export file. So this is what we're going to click on. I'm going to click on WordPress. Then I'm going to install and activate this plugin by clicking on install now. And once the plugin has been successfully installed, I'm going to activate the plugin and run the importer. Okay, so now we need to import the XML file from the theme package. So I'm going to click on choose file. Then I'm going to find the theme file that we extracted from the zip file a little bit earlier in this video. So I'm going to click on this folder right here. Then you'll see there's a folder here called demo. I'm going to click on that. And here is the XML file. So I'm going to click on the XML file and I'm going to open it to import this. Then I'm going to click on upload file and import. Okay, next up, two steps. First step, we can import the author called admin, or if we want to assign all of the posts within that file to an existing user, we can do so by clicking on this link right here. I prefer, however, to import the author as an admin because then I'll know that all that stuff we're importing is not things that I created. It's, you know, part of the theme package. So I'm going to leave it for the moment as import the author admin. Then I'm going to click on this box here that says download and import file attachments, and I'll click submit. Okay, all done, have fun, great. So I want to take a moment here to highlight this really small sentence here that says, remember to update the passwords and roles of imported users. This is really hard to see, it's often overlooked, but it's really important that we update this right now. So I'm going to go down to users, hover over users, and click on add all users. Here on the all users page, we can see when I imported the XML file and assigned all of those new posts from the file to a new user called admin, we also imported chris@angiemakes.com. So while I do want to keep this admin user, I just need to change the email from chris@angiemakes to one of my own email addresses. So to update the email address, I'm going to click on edit under admin. Then I'm going to scroll down to the email field and pop in one of my other email addresses. Then I'm going to scroll down to the bottom and update the user. So now we'll still have that admin user. We can change that later or delete it altogether. But for the moment, when I click on back to users right here, this link at the top, now we see that I still have the admin user, but now I have my email address. So that's great. So now that we've imported this XML file, now let's take a look at our homepage to see what it looks like. When I go up to the top and click on visit site, now we see on our homepage we have all these extra menu navigation items right here, and when I scroll down we see we have all this extra content as well, all of which has been imported from the XML file. So this is going to save us a lot of time in setting up our website. So let's start by changing the homepage from a blog kind of style, which is what we see here, to the other static page style where we have all of the different sliders and featured product sections featured on the home page. So in order to change our website from a blog, I'm going to go back to the dashboard. And here on the dashboard, then I'm going to go down to settings, hover over settings, and click on reading. Here on reading settings, we can see that currently the front page is displaying our latest post. However, we need to click on static page. So I'm going to click on static page, then I'm going to choose the front page, which is going to be home. And notice that we have all these pages that are now on our website. Once again, these all came from the XML file. So I'm going to click on home right here. Then under post page, I'm going to click on blog. Notice that also there's a number of different blog styles, and we can check them out and change this later. For the moment though, I'm just going to click on blog, then I'm going to scroll down to the bottom and click on save changes to save my changes. Before we leave this page, I do want to note that at the bottom here we have an option for search engine visibility, and currently I am discouraging search engines from indexing the site. However, this is something that you definitely want to come back to when the site is completed to make sure that you uncheck this. So just for peace of mind to make sure that I don't forget that, I'm going to uncheck that now so that I am actually encouraging search engines to index the site, and I'm going to click on save changes to save my changes. Okay, so let's take a look at the website to see what it looks like now. When I go up to the top and click on visit site, voila, now we can see the website is really coming together thanks to that XML file. How cool is that? So here we have all the various sections. At least they're in the right spot. Of course, we need to customize this and swap out our own content, but it's looking good so far. So here at the top, I'm going to start by customizing this message here at the top that says, put your awesome message here or leave it blank. And I'm also going to start customizing this header section. So let's go to the customize panel for this theme. To do that, I'm going to go back to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Customize. Here on the Customize panel, we'll see all the different customizations we can make for this theme, and on the right-hand side, we'll see a preview window, which will give us a real-time view of what those different customizations will look like. So first up, we have the grid. When I click on that, here we can see we can adjust the dimensions of our website. I really like the dimensions as they are, so I'm not going to adjust the dimensions, but I do want to point out that if you'd like to do so, this is where you would go. Okay, next we have the body background. Here, if you'd like to add a background image or change the color of the background or change the position, then you can adjust those settings here. I really like this clean white background, so I'm going to leave everything as it is. Next up, we have the body font, and I would like to change the font color. So when I click on body font, here we'll see all the settings for our fonts. You can change the font family if you'd like. And when I click in here, you see all these Google fonts pop up, which is really cool. There's hundreds of different Google fonts that you can choose from, which makes it really easy to change the font. I'm going to stay with the default font, however, so I'll just leave that there. Then I'm going to scroll down. You can change the font size. Let's go back. You can change the font size. You can change it to uppercase or capitalize if you'd like. You can change the font weight, the bold weight, how bold you want it to be, and you can change the font style. This is where I want to make a change though. I want to change the link color as well as the hover color because my general theme is going to be white, black, and green. So when we jump over to my finished site, here we see everything is pretty much white and black, and then I have green kind of elements highlighted here. So that's going to be, I'm keeping to three colors here, green, white, and black. So going back to my site here, I want to change all the link colors and the link hover colors to green. So when you click in there, you see there's this color panel, and this makes it really easy to change the color if you don't know the actual code. You can just spin this dial around and choose whatever color you would like. I happen to know the color for the green though, so I'm just going to pop that in here. And I'm going to do the same thing for the link hover color. I'm going to click on select color. Then I'm going to add my color code, and we're good to go. I'm going to leave all the default font sizes as they are. Those look good to me. Then I'm going to scroll up to the top and click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Okay, going back to the Customize panel, next up is the logo image. If you'd like to add a logo, which will show up here instead of just the words, you can add that here by clicking on Add Media and uploading your image. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to have just words text here instead, but I just want to point this out for the logo image if you would like to do that. Okay, next up we have the site identity. So when you first install WordPress, you're going to have this really generic tagline, just another WordPress website. So it's always a good idea to add your tagline here, or at minimum, go ahead and just delete it altogether. In this demo, I am going to add a tagline, so I'm just going to pop that in there, and then we can see it displays right underneath my site title. Cool. If you'd like to hide the title and the tagline, you can do so by simply unchecking these two boxes. This will come in handy if you do upload a logo to the header section. I don't have a logo though, so of course I need the title and I want to show the tagline, so we're good to go. Next, I'm going to click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Okay, next, going back to the Customize panel, I'm going to click on Site Title Font, and here we can change all the different settings for our site title. For this demo website, I'm going to keep all the settings as they are in the default mode, but if you'd like to adjust them, feel free. We would do so similar to the way we changed all the different settings within the body font in the previous step. Okay, going back, next up in our panel, we have the tagline font. This, of course, refers to the tagline right under the site title, and again, I'm going to leave everything as it is in default mode, but if you'd like to adjust it, make it larger, change the color, make it in caps or uppercase, you can do so in this panel right here. Okay, moving on, next up we have the header layout. In this section, I do want to make one change. For example, I want to hide the sign up or subscribe button right here in the header layout. on the left-hand side, we can do that by unchecking this box that says Show Subscribe Button. So when I uncheck that, then we see now this sign up button has been removed and it's hidden. You can also hide the social icons as well by doing the same thing, just unchecking the box. I'm going to keep the social icons, however, so I'm good to go there. I do want to point out, if you would like to keep the sign up button, you can change the text right here, and you can also change the background image if you want to replace it with some other color that matches the style and design of your website. Okay, everything else looks good to me. I'm going to go up to the top and click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Then going back to the Customize panel, clicking on the box layout, if you'd like to change the color of the box, you can do so. I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to keep it as it is, clean and white. Okay, next we have the menu font. Before diving into this website tutorial, I did experiment with the different settings within the menu font section here, and I found that the best result was when I unchecked this option, which is to enable font smoothing. So check this out, see if you like it, either with or without the font smoothing. I found that it looks a lot more stronger, the font looks stronger, when I uncheck this box. So I'm gonna keep that unchecked. Then I'm going to go up to the top and click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Back on the Customize panel, next up we have the menu bar. So when I click on the menu bar section, there's a number of different elements that I'm definitely going to be changing. For example, I'm going to be changing the background color, the font color, font hover color, and the font hover background color. So this pertains to this bar right here, as well as to the bar up above that we can't see in this view, but we'll see in just a few moments when we go to the actual home page. So starting at the top, background color, I'm going to change that to black, so I'm just going to click on black right here. And I'm also going to change the font hover background color down below, also to black. Then for the font color itself, I'm going to change this to white so that we can read the items easy on the black background. So I'm going to click on select color and choose white. And last but not least here for the font hover color, I'm going to add my green color, the same green color that I added in the previous panels. So I'm going to pop that color in right there for green, and we are good to go. So then I'm going to click on the top and click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Note at the bottom here, if you'd like to disable the sticky menu, you can do so by unchecking this. I like the sticky menu. That pertains to how, for example, when I pop over to the finish site over here, when I scroll up, note that here this menu sticks to the top of the page. I really like that because it enables your visitors to always have easy access to the menu navigation items. So I'm going to keep it enabled here for the sticky menu. Back on the Customize panel, next up we have the drop-down menu. So I'm going to click on drop-down menu right here, and here we can see there's a number of settings that I definitely need to change because throughout the website I'm swapping or changing this pink color for either a black or a green color. So the drop-down menu, actually we don't really, in this particular demo website I'm creating, I won't have any drop-down menus because here we see nothing really drops down. However, when we hop on over to the developer site, we see that Angie and Chris have created this drop-down menu here, which is essentially some sub-menu items underneath a parent menu item. So if you'd like to add this, it's important to make sure that the color of the drop-down menu is the same color as the menu bar color right up above. So we're going to adjust that right now. Going back to this panel here then, I have the background color. I need this to be black so that it matches the menu bar color right here. So I'm going to click on select color, then I'll choose black. And that looks good. Then we'll have a white color on top of the black background. So I'm just going to make sure that's set to white, which it is. Then for the font hover color, I actually want this to be green so that it matches the other font hover colors on the menu bar. So I'm going to pop in that green color I used previously. And for the font hover background color, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to make this green as well. Okay, so now the settings have been adjusted. That looks good. Now I'm going to click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Then going back to the Customize panel, just going one by one down this list, here we have the header bar, and this refers to this header up above, this part right here where we have the black background, I want white text, and I want a green link. On the developer site, we can see it's kind of a little bit of a gray with a white, sort of white font, so it's similar, but I want it to be black. So going back to our panel here, I'm going to click on select color for the top bar background color. Then I'm going to choose black. So that looks good. Then for the top bar font color, I want that to be white. So it is currently set to white, so we're good to go. And for the top bar link color and link hover color, I want both of these to be that green color. So I'm just going to pop in that green color right here. Note that throughout the website, once again, I'm only using three colors, black, white, and green. Okay, also note at the top, we can put our awesome message right here, or we can leave it blank. I actually want to put a message here, so I'm going to pop in my message right here, basically inviting anyone who visits to sign up for my email list, and in exchange, I'm going to give them some free vegan recipes. Okay, so here's my message, sign up and receive recipes, click here, and I want this click here to be an actual link. So when we hop on over to the finish site over here, we see that this is a link right here. So in order to create that link, we're just going to add some HTML. Be sure to make this really easy to see in the video. So I'm just going to add the HTML in here. It's an ahref equals. That's how you start out creating a link. Then you put quotes. Then you want to put the actual link URL. So I'm just going to grab my domain name here and pop that in. I have not yet created this page, but later on in the video, I'm going to create a page called Join. So I'm just kind of adding the link prematurely before I actually create the page. Okay, so once we have our message, then I'm going to scroll down. Here we have the menu background color, the menu font color, and the menu font hover color. And this part refers to the top menu. So when we hop on over to the finish site here, we see we have two different menus. We have a primary menu, a top menu, and a primary menu. So this section here, I want a white background and I want black font and a green hover color. So going back to the panel here, I want my menu background to be white, so that looks good. Then I want the menu font color to be black, so I'm going to choose black. And last but not least, I want the menu font hover color to be green. Okay, once the settings have been adjusted, I'm going to go up to the top and click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Then going back to the Customize panel, the next thing we need to adjust are the menus, so I'm going to click on Menus. Here on the Menus page, we can adjust our menus as well as the menu locations. However, I find that it's a lot easier to set up my menus from the Menus page on the WordPress dashboard. So I'm going to use that instead. I'm going to close this out temporarily by clicking on this X right here at the top left-hand corner. And from our dashboard, I'm going to go down to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Menus. Now, keeping in mind, when we imported that XML file earlier in this video, it came with two different menus that were also imported, both a top menu as well as a primary menu, which we can see right here on the right-hand side. So here we see we have our top menu and all of these various elements that were automatically included as a result of that XML file. As we see from my finish site over here, however, I want to adjust that because my top menu, I really only want to include three items: about, contact, and cart. So to adjust that, I'm going to go back to the menu here and I'm going to remove some of these things at least. For example, hello, I don't need that. So I'm going to click on this box right here, and then here we'll see there's a link where I can remove it. So I'm going to click on remove. I'm also going to remove favorites by clicking on that and clicking on remove. And last but not least, I'm going to click on thoughts and remove that as well. So right now I just have a contact and cart. Keep in mind, once again, these have been imported from the XML file, so there's some additional pages that we need to add, including, for example, an about page. For the moment though, I'm just going to save this top menu with only two items, contact and cart, and I'm going to click on save menu to save my menu. Once the changes have been saved for the top menu, next up, let's check out the primary menu. Here on the left-hand side, I'm going to click on top menu, and here I'm going to select the primary menu. Then I'm going to click on this button that says select to open up the primary menu. This particular menu can be found here. This is where we're headed toward now, this menu bar right here. And once again, we see I only want to add three items: a shop page, a classes page, and a blog. We haven't created the classes page, so I'll come back to that later. So right now, I just want to make sure that I have the shop and the blog on this primary menu. So going back to our menu here, we see that when we imported that XML file, it came with all of these other items, and some of them I'm going to leave just for reference. We can eliminate those and remove those later. But for now, the ones that I definitely want to remove are, for example, the fashion category, which is a blog category. So I'm going to just remove that. And I want to remove this customizations panel as well, so I'll click on that. And last but not least, I'm going to remove the home item up above. So I'm going to open that up and click on remove. These other items, short code, blog with all the blog items, and the galleries, I'm going to leave those for easy navigation so we can refer to them and find them when we want to add short codes, a blog, or various galleries. Later on in the video, we're going to remove all of these as well altogether. Finally, if you'd like to move these items around, you can do so by simply dragging the items up or down however you'd like to have them ordered. Then when you're done, go ahead and click on Save Menu to save the menu. So once our menu settings have been saved, now let's check out the website by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Here we can see our header section is coming together step by step. We've got the top menu right here and the main menu. And the one thing that I want to call attention to right now is the blog section. So when I hover over blog, we'll see here are various types of blogs we can choose from. And it looks like, first of all, we do need to make a change on the customization of the background color because green on green, I can't see that. So let's fix that really quick. It looks like I overlooked that. So we need to change the drop-down color so that the hover background is black and the actual color of the font is green. So going back to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard, then I'm going to go down to customize, appearance and customize. Then I'm going to scroll down to the drop-down menu right here and click on drop-down menu. And here we can see the font hover background color is green. That should be black. So I'm going to click on select color. And I'm going to select black, and the hover color looks okay. Now that looks good. Now I'm going to click on Save and Publish to save the changes. So that should fix that drop-down box so that now we can read the font a lot better. Once the changes have been saved, now we can go back to our website by closing it out by clicking on this X. Then I'm going to click on Visit Site by hovering over the website name and clicking on Visit Site. And now when we go to blog, now we can see when I hover over each one of these, the background is still black and I can read the words on the menu, which is so good. Now I want to point out that this particular theme comes with a variety of different blog styles, which is really cool. Here we have, for example, a gallery top, so I'm going to click on that so you can see what that looks like. As the name suggests, this blog style is going to include a gallery at the top, a slideshow gallery that you can rotate through lots of images, and then down below you'll have this Pinterest-style blog post all being displayed underneath the gallery. Pretty cool. The other options include a filter by category. This is one of my favorites because it makes it easy to find stuff. Here at the top, we'll see we have all these cool filters, and then we have this Pinterest-style two-column layout down below. Then we have our show-specific categories, so if you only want to show a specific category, you can do so. Here, this is showing only fashion posts. And last but not least, we have this blog 5 style, which is simply all posts being displayed in a three-column display with a Pinterest-style kind of display. If you prefer a traditional blog look, you can click on the blog link up above, and this will just have a vertical display of all the blog posts one by one being displayed on the page like so. Okay, so go ahead and choose the one that you like the best. I personally prefer the filter by category. However, I want to adjust this because I prefer not having a sidebar. I want to have the filter, and I want to have the Pinterest display here, but I want to have three columns and not two columns. So keeping in mind that this is the filter by category page, I'm going to go back to the dashboard by going up to the top, hovering over the website name, and clicking on dashboard. Here on the dashboard page, I'm going to go down to pages, hover over pages, and click on all pages, and here we'll see all the pages that came when we imported that XML file earlier in this video. So when I scroll down, here we can see there's a variety of different blog styles and blog pages. We don't need all of these, we only need one. So the one that I want to adjust is this one here that says filter by category. So when I click on that, I'm just going to click on that to open that page. Here we see that short code is being used to generate the display of the filter by category blog style. If you go up to this top area right here, here on the visual tab, when I click on these two brackets here, there's a drop-down menu, and when I click on that, we see there's all kinds of short code that we can add to the various pages and posts of our WordPress website without knowing any code, which is really great. Jumping back to our code here, The easiest way that I found to customize this is simply to change the number of columns here within the short code. So here, for example, we see that currently the columns are set to 2 and the gutter space between each column is set to 10. So I'm going to increase that from 2 columns to 3 columns by simply adding a 3 there instead of a 2. And for the gutter space, I'm going to change it from 10 to 0.020 so that there's less space in between each column. That will give space for the third column. Then I'm just going to come up to the top and click on Update to update this page. Okay, so let's take a look at the page now by going up to the top and clicking on View Page. And here we can see we're moving in the right direction because I have my filters here and now I have 3 columns. However, I still have this sidebar right here, so I want to remove the sidebar altogether. To do that, I'm going to go up to the top and click on Edit Page. Then here on the right-hand side underneath Page Attributes, you see that there is an option here for the template. So right now it's set to include a sidebar with no heading. When I click on this, we need to choose the one that has no sidebar at all. So we want a full width and no heading instead. So I'm simply swapping out with the sidebar and no heading for full width and no heading. Once I've set the template, then I'm going to click on Update to update this page. Okay, so now that the page has been saved, let's check it out by once again clicking on View Page. And voila, now the page looks exactly how I want it. We have our filters here so we can easily find stuff within the blog, and at the same time, we have a full width page with 3 columns and this Pinterest style layout of all the various blog posts. So cool. So next up, we need to change our blog items here because we don't need all of these different blog styles in our lineup here. All we need is one. So I'm going to delete all of these and I'm only going to keep the current one we're on, which is the filtered blog style. So going up to the top, I'm going to click on Edit Page. And here we can see the one that I want to keep is blog style 2, filter by category. So I'm going to delete all the others by going to all pages, by clicking on all pages. Then I'm going to scroll down and I'm going to delete everything that is not blog 2. So for example, blog 3, blog 4, and blog 5. And this main blog post page right here, I'm going to select that as well. Then I'm going to come up to the top and click on Move to Trash to move all of these to the trash. Then I'll click Apply. Once the pages have been moved to the trash, I'm going to click on Trash right here, and I'm going to delete all of these by highlighting all of them, and then in Bulk Actions, clicking on Bulk Actions, clicking on Delete Permanently, and then clicking on Apply. Okay, once all those pages have been deleted, now I'm going to go back to All by clicking on the All link right here. And now when I scroll down to the bottom, here we see Blog Style 2 is listed right here, so I'm going to click on Quick Edit because as we see, the current slug is blog-option-2 and there's no other blog to choose from, so I'd rather keep things simple and simply have it say blog. So I'm going to delete the -option-2 so it simply says blog, and I'm also going to change the title so this simply says blog as well. Then I'm going to click on Update to update these settings. Okay, so here we have the blog. Awesome. So now I'm going to go back to settings by hovering over settings here and going to reading. We need to check our front display because previously here for the front page display, we had had the other traditional blog page selected. And once we deleted it, we also deleted our setting for the post page. So I'm going to click on this and choose blog and then come to the bottom and click on Save Changes. The last change we need to make is under the menu page, so I'm going to go to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Menus. And now we can see our main menu is missing the blog, so we need to add that back in. So I'm going to click on View All here, and I'm going to click on Blog right there, and click on Add to Menu. So here we have our blog. I'm going to delete the one right above it, which is Blog Style 3, Filter by Category, by clicking on Remove. Okay, so now I have the blog, we're good to go. So then I'm going to click on Save Menu to save my menu. So once the menu has been saved, let's check out our website by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. And here we can see our primary menu is coming together. We've got our shop page, our blog page, and we have this Short Codes and Galleries page. Now, I'm going to be deleting these two pages, Short Codes and Galleries, but these are good pages to keep as drafts as a reference so you can see how to add any of the short codes that are available within this theme as well as galleries. So for example, when I click on galleries, we'll see that there's a number of different galleries that are possible within this theme. As it notes at the top, all of these galleries can display or hide captions. You can easily add any of the galleries below to any page, even your home page, when you choose to make it a static page instead of a blog page. That's what we've done. Also, mosaic galleries support 1 to 9 columns. So just check out this page. You can see you can create mosaic galleries with 3 columns, with 5 columns, with 8 columns, and you can also insert carousels of various sizes as well. For the shortcodes page, I'm going to click on that. Here we can see all the available elements that are possible with shortcodes within this beautiful theme. So scrolling down, if you want to add an accordion, you can do so with shortcode, or a tab. You can add toggles. Also, a variety of different layouts for columns and sections are possible within this theme. You can add buttons, testimonials, all kinds of borders, Google Maps. The list goes on and on. All these social icons, progress bars, and my favorite, we'll be adding this later on in the video, is a customized pricing table. We'll be adding this later on in the video. So anyway, be sure to check out all the possibilities within the shortcodes page right here. For the moment, I'm going to remove it from the menu bar, and I'm going to turn these into draft form so that they're not published on the website. So going back to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard, then I'm going to go down to pages and all pages. Then I'm going to find the shortcodes and galleries page, and I'm going to do a quick edit by clicking on quick edit. And here where it says published, I'm going to turn this to draft. Then I'm going to click on update to update that change. I'm going to do the same thing for galleries. Click on quick edit, then click on published. I'm going to choose draft to turn this into a draft. Then I'll click on update. So now that those changes have been saved, I'm going to go back to the menu by going to appearance and menus. And here where it says shortcodes and galleries, I'm going to remove these from the menu bar. So I'm just going to click on remove for shortcodes and click on remove for galleries. So now the primary menu has only 2 items, shop and blog. We'll be adding a new page called classes a little bit later in this video. Then I'm going to click on save menu to save my menu. So now let's check out the website. When I go up to the top and click on visit site, now we can see we only have 2 items in our primary menu bar, so it's looking good. We have a few pages to add, and when we add those pages, we'll also add them here to the top menu bar as well as the primary menu bar. For now, I want to adjust all of these social icons that are being displayed in the header section. I definitely don't want all of them, but I do want a few of them, so let's adjust that now. To adjust social icons, go back to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard. Then go down to appearance, hover over appearance, and click on shortcodes. Here we can see the social media tab with all the various social media icons checked. So I definitely don't want all of them, but again, I want some of them. So I want, for example, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram, and I don't want any of these other ones. So I'm going to uncheck all of these other ones. I do want custom 3, that's the YouTube one, and I don't think I need the Google one right now, so I'll just keep it with these 5. Then down below, you can add your Facebook link right here, your Google, your Twitter, and all the URLs for the various social icons that you want to have displayed within the header section. When you're done, scroll to the bottom and click on Save Changes to save the changes. Once the settings have been saved, next up, let's check out the website by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Here on the homepage of our website, we can see in the header section our social media icons with the new display here on the right-hand side. Great. So a few things that we need to do now is we need to create some pages so that we can add them to the top menu as well as the primary menu. And we also need to swap out all of these default images that come with the theme with our own images that match what our website is about. So let's take care of swapping out these images first. To do that, we need to edit the home page. So to edit the home page, you can either come up to the top and click on Edit Page here, or you can go to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard, then go down to pages, hover over pages, and click on all pages. Then find the home page, which is right here, and click on Edit. Here we can edit the home page, and we see that by default, when we installed that XML file earlier in this video, all of this content was pre-populated on the home page, which makes it really easy for us to adjust and swap out this content for our own content. So to change these images here, first up, note that the image dimensions need to be 5 and 4, so 5 times wide and 4 times tall, whatever that ratio is for your images would be the best image. And keep in mind, when we're adding images to our homepage, it's always better to start with a larger image and have that larger image be reduced than to start with a small image and have it be enlarged. That's because when you start with a small image, it's going to expand to fill the whole homepage, the width at least, and it's going to get really blurry if you're starting with a small image. So make sure that you're using a large enough image. In this video, I'll show you in just a few moments what the dimensions are of the images that I'm uploading. So to swap out these images, I'm going to click on this box right here, and we can see when I click on this area, then we get this tool, this little pencil, as well as an X to remove the whole gallery. I don't want to remove it. I do want to edit it though, so I'm going to click on the pencil to edit the gallery. And here we see all the images that are included in the gallery. Now note that when I hop on over to my finished site over here, we can see that I have one image. I'm going to have a static image. You can also have a slider if you'd like, however. I'll show you how to do both variations in just a moment. Then we have these three smaller images down below, each of which has a description on the top. So going back to our gallery over here, first of all, I only need 4 images because as we see here, I only have 4 images. I have one large image and then 3 smaller images. So here on the gallery, I can remove at least a couple of these so that we have now 4 images. Okay, so next up, I want to add to the gallery by clicking on this left-hand link right here, Add to Gallery. Then I'm going to click on Upload Files and select Files. Then I'm going to find all my files, and the cool thing is you can upload all these images all at once by highlighting all of them. So I'm just going to highlight every single image that I want to upload, then I'm going to click on Open to upload all of these images. Once all the images have been uploaded to your WordPress website, next up we need to give each image a title as well as an alternative text. This is important for search engines as well as for any of your visitors who are using text-to-speech software in order to understand what this image is about. So starting with the first one, I'm just going to highlight that one. Then on the right-hand side, I'm going to give it a title as well as an alternative text. Once you've added a title and alternative text to each of the images, you can click on this button at the bottom that says Add to Gallery to add your images to the gallery. Then we need to order the images in the order we'd like to see them displayed. So for example, I want this image to be my main slider, so I'm going to drag it to the top left hand in position number 1. Then these other images can be right after it. Note that I only need 4 images, so I'm just going to keep these 4 here, and I'll keep 1 image right here so I can show you how the slider works. I'm going to remove it at the end though, so I'm going to just delete these other ones that I don't need, and I'm going to leave all the gallery settings here on the right hand side as they are. Note that here it says display slider and 3 bottom links. That is what is responsible for creating this effect with a slider and then 3 links below. Okay, so let's see what this looks like. I'm just going to scroll to the bottom, then I'm going to click on Update Gallery to update my gallery, then I'm going to click on Update to update the page. Once a page has been updated, we can check it out by clicking on View Page, and voila, now we see we have our slider at the top and our 3 images. Now, as I mentioned earlier in this video, I don't want to actually feature a slider. I really want to just have a static image here, but I did want to show you how it would look and how to create a slider if you'd like. I want to have a static image, so I'm going to go back and I'm going to delete one of these images. Also, we need to add our titles on top of each of these 3 boxes down below. So going up to the top, I'm going to click on Edit Page. Then I'm going to click on this gallery one more time and click on the pencil to edit it. And here we can see we can add our caption right down below. Now I don't want this image, so I'm going to delete that all together. And I'm going to add a caption under each one of the 3 bottom images. Now keep in mind that each of these 3 images right here, the shop, classes, and recipes, these are going to be displayed down below here on my This is my finished website. So when we scroll down, we can see that I have a title on each of these images down below. And when I click on each of them, they're going to go to their own page related to that title. So for example, that one will go to my shop page. So back on our gallery, to create those links on each of these boxes, I'm going to click on this one, for example. And on the right hand side, we can see now here are the attachment details, which when I scroll down, there's this option field right here to link to some kind of URL. So I'm going to pop in my URL right there. This is going to be the shop page. Of course, I haven't yet created the shop page, but I will be creating the shop page a little bit later in this video. And for now, I'm just going to set up the link so that it goes to the proper page. I know now that I'm going to be calling that page shop. Okay, same with this one, classes. I know that's going to eventually be the classes page, so I'll just title it as such with the domain name /classes, and last but not least, the recipes page, I will add that as well. Okay, so once you have all of those links added, go ahead and click on Update Gallery to update the gallery. Now we can update the page by clicking on Update. Okay, so once the gallery has been updated, then we're going to scroll down the homepage, and here we can see we have a description right here, which when we pop on over to our finished site, I actually want to swap that out for my own short sentence right here. So here in this section, I'm going to highlight all of this and delete it, and I'm going to add my own sentence here instead. Now I want to center this as well, so I'm going to highlight all of it, and then with these formatting icons up here, I'm going to align center by clicking on the align center icon. Okay, that looks great. Then I have my divider, and then we move into my featured products. Underneath the featured products, then we have our latest blog post section, and once again we can see this is all short code, which was generated by using this bracket right here. So you can add all kinds of different posts by checking out the short code. I actually don't want to feature blog posts on my homepage, however. I really want to keep the focus on the products only. So here's our finished site. We can see we have our image and then our three links with images, then our sentence and our featured products, and then we move directly into the footer section. So I want to keep the homepage really clean and focused on my products. So I want to remove the blog post section altogether. So I'm just going to highlight everything and delete it. And last but not least, here where it says featured image, we can remove this default image that came with the theme by simply clicking on remove featured image. Once image has been removed, I'm just going to scroll to the top and click on update to update my new home page. So once the page has been updated, now let's check it out by clicking on view page. And now we see underneath the header section, we have our main image right here, which still has, it looks like, these controls here. So I do want to remove those, but okay, the image looks good. Then when I have my three boxes, each of which will go to a separate page on my website, then I have my sentence, and then I have my featured products, followed by the footer. So we can see I haven't yet added the e-commerce features to the website, which is why we only see the short code here, and that is okay. So before we jump into adding the e-commerce features to our website, and before we create the footer section down below, I want to add some extra pages to our site so we can start filling out the top menu bar as well as the primary menu bar. So for example, when I hop over to the finished site over here, we see that we have an about page as well as a classes page. And when I click on classes, it's going to feature a pricing table related to the various classes that I'm going to offer on my website. So let's go about creating those extra pages now, starting with the About page. So going back to our website, I'm going to click on Dashboard to go to the dashboard. Then to create a new page, you can either go to Pages, hover over Pages and click on Add New, or at the top here, you can hover over plus New and click on Page. Once you click on Add New Page, you get the Add New Page screen, and here we can first up give our new page a title. So I'm going to call this About because this will be the About page. Then in this white box here, I'm going to add my content. Keeping in mind that once again, here we are in the Visual tab, and just like an email or a Word document, you can format all the content in this box simply by using these formatting icons. And I also want to add an image to my About page. So I'm going to place the cursor where I want the image to be displayed, which is at the top on the left-hand side, and I'm going to click on Add Media, then Upload File, and I'm going to choose my file by clicking on Select Files. Then I'll select the file I'd like to upload and click on Open to upload the image to my WordPress website. As we did with the other images we added, I need to give my new picture image a title as well as an alternative text. Once I've added a title and alternative text, I can scroll down to the bottom. The alignment, I want this to be right aligned, so that looks good. I want this to link to nothing, so I'll leave it as none. And I want the full size, so I'll keep it as full size. Then I'm going to click on Insert into Page to insert my image into the page. Once the image has been added to the page, then you can update or publish the page by clicking on the blue button over here that says Publish or Update. Okay, so once a page has been published, then we can check it out by clicking on View Page. And here we have our About page. Awesome. So next up, I want to create a classes page where I list out the various classes I have along with a customized pricing table. To do that, once again, I'm going to create a new page by going up to the top, hovering over plus new, and clicking on page. Here at the top of my new page, I'm going to give my page a title, so I'll just call this classes. Then down below in the white box, I'm going to add the content related to my page. Also note here is the permalink. This is the URL that's related to this page, and I don't want to have all these words. Instead, I simply want it to say classes, so I'm going to remove the first two words and just call it classes. Then I'll click on OK. Now after this white section here, or all this content, I want to add a customized pricing table. So to do that, I'm going to place the cursor where I want the pricing table to be displayed. And we can add the pricing table by using short codes, which can be found by clicking on these brackets right here on the top right hand side. Here in the short code section, first up, I need to add three columns. So to add three symmetrical columns, I'm going to click on this one for three columns that are exactly the same dimensions, 1/3, 1/3, 1/3. So it'll click on that. Then we'll see that WordPress will generate the short code for each one of our columns. Here we have the first column right here with an opening bracket, column size is 1/3, and then it closes right there. Then we have our second column right here, so I'll just create a space so we can see it a little bit easier. Here's our second column, and last but not least, we have our third column right here, and as we can see, it says last. Okay, so we need to add our pricing table and place the pricing table in between all of these column brackets. So starting at the top, here where it says WC row and the column size is 1/3, here where it says sample content, this is where we add our pricing table. So I'm going to remove the word sample content, and in its place, I'm going to go up to the top, click on these carrots, go down to elements, and click on pricing table. So first up, for our first pricing table, I want to change the name from basic to a more descriptive name related to my classes I'm going to be offering. So I'll call this 4-hour cooking crash course. And I'm also going to change the cost from the default cost right here to, let's say, $70. Then instead of per month, I'll just say per person, since this is one class. And last but not least here, we need to add our button URL, making sure that we add the URL in between the quotation marks. So you need to make sure that you do have quotation marks both before and after the link that you add. Finally, here we can replace the default features with the features of whatever it is that you're adding to your pricing table. Okay, so the first pricing table looks good. Now I'm going to move down to the second column where I can add the second pricing table. Once again, repeating the steps that we just did in the previous example, I'm going to highlight sample content here and delete it. Then go up to these short codes right here, go down to elements, and click on pricing table. Then, as we did previously, I'm going to replace the default content with my own content related to my second class. So instead of basic, I will call this the Vegan Cooking Weekend Course. Then I'll change the cost to $150 for a weekend course. Instead of writing per month, I'll call this once again per person. And last but not least, I'm going to add my button URL in between these two quotation marks. Finally, I'm going to replace all the content in this featured section with my own content related to this course. So now that I have the second pricing table customized, last up, I have the last remaining one in the third column. Okay, so once you've added customized content for each of the pricing tables, then come up to the top and click on Publish to publish your new page. So once a page has been published, I want to point out a few things related to the colors of the pricing tables. So when I scroll down here, we'll see that each one of these pricing table types says primary. That means that each of the tables of the pricing tables are going to have the same color. Instead, I'd like each one of them to have a different color. So for the first table, the first pricing table in the first column, I'm going to use the pricing table type of inverse. So I'm just going to type in inverse here. Next, for column number two's pricing table, I'm going to scroll down. And for that one, I will leave it as pricing table type of primary. And for column three pricing table, I'm going to change that one to secondary. So here where it says pricing type equals, I'm going to change primary to secondary, making sure that I keep the quotations before and after secondary, like so. So we have a quotations, secondary, and then a quotation. Okay, now I'm going to update this by clicking on update. So once the page has been published and updated, I'm going to click on view page to view my page. And here we see we have our pricing table as well as our classes page. Now, we haven't yet customized the colors. I'll come back to that a little bit later. We need to do that in the customize panel. For now, I want to add these two pages we just added both to the top menu bar as well as to the primary menu bar. So to do that, I'm going to go up to the top, hover over the website name, and go directly to menus. Then here we can see we're on the main menu right here. So for this one, I want to add classes. So I'm going to click on view all. Then I'm going to scroll down and click on the classes link page that I just created and click on add to menu. Then I'm going to add that in between both the shop and the blog. And I want to change it from vegan cooking classes to simply say classes. So I'm going to remove the first two words there and just call it classes to keep it simple. Then I'll click on save menu to save my menu. Once the main menu has been saved, next up I want to adjust the top menu. So I'm going to click on the top menu right here and then click on select. And here on the top menu, I want to add the about page. So I'm going to click on about, click on add to menu, and then I'm going to move this up to the top so it shows up first in the lineup. Then I'm going to click on save menu to save my menu. Okay, so let's check it out on the website. When I go up to the top and click on visit site, cool, now we see the top menu looks good. I have the extra menu item right there, and I have my next. And in the main menu, I have my extra menu item here called classes. Great. So before we move forward and start adding the e-commerce features to our website, I want to take care of some loose ends that I've noticed here in the header section. First of all, I checked this behind the scenes, and now it looks like our blog, which we customized, when I click on blog, here we'll see that our filter is no longer there and it's kind of reverted into a standard kind of blog format, which looks really lovely. If you'd like to keep it like this, go ahead. This looks really nice. However, as we did in the previous step, I really want to have filters and I want to have the Pinterest display with the various images. So in order to correct that issue, I'm going to go back up to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to settings and reading. And here where it says post page for front page displays, I'm actually just going to not choose anything. I'm going to leave it unselected. Then I'm going to come down and click on save changes to save my changes. Now when I go back up to the site by clicking on visit site, now we'll notice when I click on blog, now my beautiful Pinterest style blog display is back. So that's what we need to do in order to make this display. I'm not sure why that happens, but as long as we have a solution, we are good to go. Okay, next up, I want to adjust the contact page. When I click on this, this was a page that came with the XML file that we imported earlier in the video. And as we see here, it says, this theme is compatible with contact form 7 to create the form. So I just want to kind of clean up this page right here. So let's do that now. To go up, I'm going to go up to the top and click on edit page. And here we see we have all this short code right here that is related to contact form 7. So when I click on the visual tab, we have a better, easier way to look at it. So for example, I can replace this whole part at the top. And of course, here is the beginning of the short code, so I will definitely leave that intact. I'm not going to change that, but I am going to remove this part here for default contact form because we really don't need that. So I'm going to delete that part right there, and it looks okay. So now we have my opening sentence, and then we have the beginning of the short code, then we have the contact form 7 short code, which we'll adjust in just a moment, and we have this image, which I want to change. So I'm going to click on this, then I'm going to remove it all together by clicking on the remove button, and in its place I'm going to add, and also make sure that you want to make sure that the cursor is before the last short code ends. So make sure that you place the cursor before the last short code. Then I'm going to add an image by coming up to the top and clicking on Add Media. Then I'll choose the same image of myself before that I used before, so I'll use that. And I want this to be displayed on the right. Everything looks good. Then I'll click on Insert into Page. Okay, then I'm going to update this page by clicking on Update. Great, so once the page has been updated, let's check it out by clicking on View Page. And here we are on the contact page. Perfect. So the other thing I want to do really quick for the contact page is we need to make sure that we have the correct email address set up so that emails or messages that are used and sent via this form go to the right inbox. So this is a really important element that's often overlooked within contact form 7. So to make sure that the inbox is the correct one, namely ours, let's go up to Edit Page by clicking on Edit Page. Then we'll see here the short code shows what the short code is for contact form 7. So here we see we're using contact form 1 and the ID number is 4. This is the important part. So keeping in mind that this is ID number 4, going to the contact form on the left-hand side here, I'm going to hover over contact and click on contact form. Now, of course, there's a few ways that we can go about this. We can either create an entirely new contact form by coming up above here and clicking on Add New and making sure that our email address is correct, or we can use one of the contact forms that are already listed on our site. These were imported with our import of that XML file earlier in this video. So here, for example, we see here is the short code for ID number 4. We can see the author is admin, so that lets us know this is from the XML file. So to make sure that the email is correct, I'm going to click on Edit underneath Contact Form 1. Here's all the short code that is generating the actual fields for the form right here. Then the important part is clicking on this Mail tab right here. Now note that when we imported this, we also imported it with this email right here, which is not the correct email for us. So go ahead and add your own email. I'll add mine right there. Then you want to scroll to the bottom. Then here's another section for the message body. Note that it says this email was sent from a contact form on, and then there's here this other website. So you want to make sure that this part as well reflects your website URL. So once you've added your own email address in the to field, and you've updated the message to include your website in the message body, then we are good to go. Come to the bottom and click on save. Making these two important changes will ensure that messages sent to you via your website form go to your email address. Okay, so going back to our website, let's see what we need to do next. Going up to the top, I'm going to hover over the website name and click on Visit Site. Okay, so here we are on the homepage. The header looks all set and ready to go. Then we have our slider image or one static image. Then we have our three images here which link to various pages. And here we have our tagline or sentence, and then we have our featured product. So one more thing before we start diving into the e-commerce section, I want to add a footer section here with a variety of content. Hopping over to our finished site over here, the content that I want to add is an Instagram feed on the left-hand side, an email opt-in form, and some quick links so anyone can easily navigate to additional pages within the website. So let's start by adding the Instagram feed here on the left-hand side. To do that, we're going to be adding some footer widgets. So going back to our website, I'm going to go up to the top and I'm going to click on Dashboard. Then here on the dashboard, I'll go down to Plugins, hover over Plugins, and click on Add New. Now there's a variety of really awesome Instagram plugins that we can add to our WordPress website, but the one that I want to add now is called Instagram Feed. So here we see it on the left-hand side. It has over 100,000 active installs with a pretty much a 5-star rating, which is awesome. So I'm going to install this by clicking on Install Now. And once a plugin has been successfully installed, I'm going to activate it by clicking on Activate Plugin. Once a plugin has been activated, then we need to set all the settings within the plugin. So coming down to Instagram feed right here in our lineup, we see there's a link called Settings. I'm going to click on settings, and here we see step number one is we need to configure the plugin. So we need to log in to our Instagram and access our access token and our user ID. So I'm going to click on this blue button right here, which brings us to Instagram, where we need to log in to our Instagram account. Once we log into Instagram, then the access token and the user ID will automatically be pulled and will be entered within these two fields. Once the token and the ID have been filled here in these fields, we need to copy and paste them into this field right here and this field right here. Once you've added the token and the ID, you can scroll to the bottom and click on Save Changes to save your changes. Next step, we need to customize our field. So I'm going to click on the Customize button. Then you can customize how you want the Instagram feed to be displayed. So for example, I'm going to leave all this stuff at the top as it is, but I'm going to scroll down, and here for the number of photos, I want to add 6 photos and I want to have 3 columns. Then I'm going to scroll to the bottom and click on Save Changes to save my changes. Okay, so once the customizations have been saved, then I want to display the Instagram feed by clicking on Display Your Feed. Here we'll see there's a number of different shortcodes that we can use. The one that I want is this one, just bracket Instagram feed. So I'm going to highlight and copy that shortcode. Then I want to go to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Widgets. Here in the Widgets page, I can open the footer by clicking on this caret here, and the one that I want to add is a text widget, so I'm going to scroll to the bottom here, grab this text widget, drag it to the footer section, then I'll give it a title, and here in the content box, I want to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. This is the Instagram feed shortcode. Then I'm going to scroll to the bottom and click on Save to save my changes. Next up, I want to add a customized email opt-in form. So what we're going for is this right here. I have a custom email form on my finished website. Now I've already created a tutorial showing you step-by-step how to set up this customized email opt-in form using the Magic Action Box plugin for WordPress. So I'm going to be sure to drop that link down below so you can check it out, but this is the video that I've posted on my website that walks you step by step from scratch, showing you how to set up an email opt-in form and add it to your website. So be sure to check this video out. Behind the scenes, I'm going to be following the steps in this video to set up my Magic Action Box right here, and I'll see you on the other side once I've added that to my footer. So I've added the custom email opt-in form using the Magic Action Box plugin for WordPress following the steps in my previous video. Next up, I want to add some links for the third and final column in the footer. What we're going for is this effect over here on the finished site. We have here in the third column of the footer, we have a number of links so that my visitors can easily find stuff on my website. So next up, let's add some links to our footer. To do that, I'm going to go back to my widgets page here. And once again, we need to drag a text widget up to the third footer section. So I'm going to grab text and I'm going to drag it up here to the top, place it just under the email opt-in form. I'll give it a title, and then I need to add all the various links here that I want to have displayed within the footer. So for example, I want an about page, a contact page, and a shop page. Now in order to display this properly so that each link is one on top of one another, we need to add some HTML. So the HTML I'm going to add is a break tag, which is looks like that. So I'm going to add that twice after the first and second items so that it forces the item to be pushed down below so everything is lined up vertically. Next, I need to add some HTML for a link. An HTML looks like this. There's a bracket, a href equals a quotation, and then here you want to add your actual link. So I'm going to grab that, highlight it and copy it, place it right before the actual text. Then, after the text, I need to add a closing bracket, which looks like this. Okay, so then I'm just going to repeat that 2 more times for the contact link and the shop link. Okay, so once we have the HTML for the link, then we have the word itself, and then the closing bracket for the link, then we have a break tag right there to force the next item to go down to the next line. We're all ready to go. Then I'm just going to scroll to the bottom and click on Save to save my changes. Okay, so now that we've added the various widgets within the footer section, let's check out our website. Going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site, here we have the header at the top. We have our main image with our other links going to various pages, Then we have at the bottom, here we have our footer section. Awesome. Now, of course, we need to adjust the color because this color is definitely off. So let's head back to the customizer panel, the customize panel for the theme, to adjust the rest of the colors in this website. So going up to the top, we can either customize by clicking on this link here that says customize, or we can go to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard. Then going down to appearance and then clicking customize. So earlier in the video, we covered a lot of the settings within the customize panel and we left off about halfway through. So going down to where we left off, it was right around the menu section. So let's see, here it was. We left off right here, menus. Now we've already covered widgets and we just did that, so we're good to go. We've already done this, static front page. Page, title, font. Let's just go down these and make sure we have them all set. So I'm just going to click on this. That looks good. Everything is good. I'm really looking for the pink color because, as mentioned, I want to swap the pink out for black, white, or green. So heading font, here we go. Here we have some pink color. So I definitely want to change the link and I want to change the font color. So starting with the font, I want to change this from this gray to black. So I'll click on black. And I also want to change the link color and the link hover color. So here in the link color, I'm going to click on select color. Then I'm going to pop in the green color that I have been using in the rest of the video. And for the link hover color, I'm going to do the same thing, pop in that green color. Then I'm just going to scroll down. Everything else looks great, so I'll just leave everything else as it is. Then I'm going to come up to the top and click on save and publish to save my changes. Then going back, I'm going to click on the back button, go down to date font. This looks great. Everything is good. Quote font. That looks good as well. Post meta font, here we have some more font colors. So I'll leave those as they are. Then we have our buttons. So here we see, once again, I have a pink color for the button background color. So I wanna change that once again to my favorite color, which is green. Green, actually it's not my favorite color, but one of my favorite colors. So green is what we'll have for the background color for the font and for the font color so we can easily see it, I'll make that white. Be a very clean website. Okay, once we have those colors set, everything else looks good. So once again, I'll click on save and publish to save those changes. Then going back, let's see, we've covered the buttons. Next up is content. So this is where we need to change a few more things here for the content. For example, here, the caption link color, we will make that green. And everything else looks good, so I'll leave everything else as it is for the moment. We can always come back and change these later when we discover things along the way. So for now, I'll just click on save and publish to save those changes and go back. Now we have the blog. We've already kind of created the blog, but here you have additional settings for the blog if you'd like to adjust anything. I'm going to leave everything in default mode as it is. Then I'll go back, the sidebar display. If you would like to, it says check the pages where you want the sidebar to display by default. So definitely on the post, not on the blog. I don't want it on the blog. Search, archives, I'll take it off on these. I kind of want to keep a really clean layout, so I'm only going to display the sidebar on the actual single blog post. Then I'll click on save and publish to save those changes and go back. And next up we have the sidebar widget title font. So if you'd like to adjust that, do so here. Then the footer widgets, this is where we can change the background color for the footer section. So now we see that it's pink and I want to have it be black so that it matches the black bar up above in the website. So going down, I want to change this pink for black. So here where it says background color, I'm going to turn that to be black. And that looks really good. And then in order to see the titles a little bit better, I want to change the titles from gray to white. So here where it says title color, I'm going to select that, click on white, and I'll leave the accent color as it is, but I want all of these things to be white so I can easily see them. So the title color, that is already white, so that looks good. The font color, I want this to be white as well. So once again, I can easily read it on a black background. Then I'll change the link color as well to the green. Let's see what that looks like now. The cool thing about this display on the right is we can see what it's looking like in real time. So when I scroll down, here we see these are going to pop up as green. That looks pretty cool, so I think I'm going to leave that as it is. For the link hover color, I think I'll make that white. So here we can see in our sandbox what that looks like. When I hover on top of it, it turns white. that looks pretty good, so I'll leave it like that. Finally, at the bottom, you see that we have the button font background color, and this I for sure want to turn green, so I'm going to select the color and turn that green. And for the button font color, in order to read easily on top of a green background, I'm going to make that white. Last but not least, I'll also make the border color white as well. Okay, I think we're good to go. One last thing is actually the green. I don't really like that. I do want to make the link color to be simply white so everything is clean. So I'll just change that to white. Okay, great. Once you have all the settings set, go ahead and click on Save and Publish to save your changes. Then going up to the top, I'm going to click on the back button and go down to Foot Citer Info. Here we have the link color for the foot site info. That is this stuff down here below. And the font color looks good. I'll keep it as that. However, for the link color, I want to make that to be the same color as the font color. This part refers to this copyright info down here in the bottom, right below the actual footer section down below. And for the link hover color, I'll make that green. Once you've made the changes to the colors for the fonts and the links, we also can adjust the copyright text here. So here we see by default, it said site made with love, heart, by Angie Makes. So here I want to change that to my URL. And instead of saying site made, I'll just say copyright, and then I'll just add my URL here. Okay, so once you've adjusted the copyright text, go ahead and click on Save and Publish to save your changes. Then going back, I'm going to click the back button and move on to colors. Okay, here we see there's a number of colors that we can change here as well, and I definitely want to change these pink or yellow colors at the bottom. So for the inverse, I'm going to select the color and I'll make this green. And for the inverse contrast, I'm going to make that white. Okay, once the changes have been saved, go ahead and click on Save and Publish to save your changes. Then going back, moving on, we have our favicon. If you'd like to create a favicon, you can do so, and you can learn more about that by going to favicon.cc. I'm not going to add that now, I just want to point it out for your reference. Then going back here where it says responsive, yes, I do want to enable responsive behavior. That will make the website look really nice on mobile devices like smartphones and tablets and iPads, so I definitely want that checked. Then I'm going to go back, and here we have all of our custom fonts. So these have been loaded with the theme, so I'm not going to touch anything here, but if you'd like to add additional fonts, here is where you can do so. Last but not least, we have our custom CSS panel here, so when I click on that, here we can add custom CSS. So I'll follow up with this later on in the video after we see what our website looks like. For now, I just want to point out this is where you would add custom CSS for this theme. Okay, so closing this out, let's take a look at our website now. When I click on the X, then at the top, I'm going to click on Visit Site. Okay, so here on the homepage, we can see that our website is really coming together. We have our header section, we have our main image right here, along with our images to our links. And here we have our footer section down below. Awesome. So as we can see, we still have to add the e-commerce products to our website so that the short code actually displays products. So the end result we're going for is here on my finished site. Here we can see that we have some products right above the footer section right here. So next up, let's add the e-commerce features and products to our WordPress website. To add e-commerce products to our WordPress website, we're going to be using WooCommerce, a free e-commerce plugin for WordPress that also happens to be one of the most popular plugins, if not the most popular e-commerce plugin, powering thousands and thousands of e-commerce stores online around the world. So let's add WooCommerce to our WordPress website. To do that, I'm going to go back to my dashboard by scrolling to the top and clicking on Dashboard. Then going down to Plugins, I'm going to click on Installed Plugins. And here we can see all the installed plugins that have already been added to our WordPress website. Note that we do not yet have WooCommerce though, so next up we need to add a new plugin by clicking on this button here that says Add New. Then here I'll do a search in the plugin search field. And here we can see WooCommerce plugin on the top left-hand side. There's over a million active installs with close to a 5-star rating. So this is a really awesome e-commerce plugin for WordPress. I'm going to install it by clicking on Install Now. Once a plugin has been successfully installed, I'm going to activate it by clicking on Activate Plugin. Okay, so once a plugin has been activated, now we'll see another item here in our lineup and under our dashboard called WooCommerce with all the various settings for WooCommerce. And we also see our products item here with lots of things we can adjust for our products. So starting with WooCommerce here, I'm going to click on WooCommerce, then go to Settings, and here in the General tab at the top, you can choose your base location. So I'm in California, so I'm going to leave it set to California. I'm going to sell to all countries. If you'd like to adjust countries, you can do so by just clicking in here. Then for the rest of the options, I'm going to leave all the defaults in set to how they are. For example, currency is set to US dollars. That's good because I'm in California. The currency position is on the left. That looks good. So all of this looks good. I'm going to leave everything else as it is, and I'm going to click on Save Changes. So be sure to go through all of these individually and see what is best for your store, depending on where you live and what you are doing with your online store. The cool thing is with this, here we have these question marks, which when you hover on top of them, they'll give you a tooltip that will tell you exactly what this field is about. There's also more documentation at the woothemes.com site, so I'll be sure to drop a link down below. But here we can see there's all kinds of documentation related to WooCommerce. So whatever you need to do for your online store, you can most likely find it here within the documentation at woothemes.com. Going back to the settings, next up we have our products. So I'm going to click on products here. I'm just going to cover the general overview to get WooCommerce up and running. But I want to emphasize that every store is different and everyone has unique needs. So please be sure to make sure that you adjust things so that it makes sense for your online store. So for the weight unit, for example, pounds sounds good to me, so I will leave it as pounds. Dimensions, I'll leave that as centimeters. And all the other defaults related to product ratings, I'll leave those as well. Also note, there's these other links up above for display, inventory, and downloadable products. So when I click on display, here we can see we need to create a shop page. So I believe we already have a shop page. I'll go double check in a moment, but this is an important page for all of us to make sure that this is set up so that our pages are working properly. So here when I click on select a page, here there is a page there called shop. So I'm going to click on that shop. Display products, shop page display, show products. That looks good. Everything else looks good. Here are the product image dimensions. If you'd like to change those, you can do so here. Then I'm going to click on Save Changes to save my changes. Okay, next up is inventory. I'm not going to be capturing inventory for my online store, but this is where you would manage your inventory. Also, make sure that you want to make sure that your email for the notifications is set correctly right in this field right here. Then whenever you've made your changes, go ahead and click on Save Changes to save your changes. With WooCommerce, you can also add downloadable products to your online store. So I'm going to click on that. Here we can see all the various settings for downloadable products. Cool. So moving on to taxes. Taxes are unique for every online store. So once again, I'm going to refer you to the really great documentation at woothemes.com for taxes. Next up, within WooCommerce, we have our checkout settings. Here at the top, you can enable coupons if you'd like, so I'm going to leave that checked. And here, if you'd like to enable guest checkout, I'm going to leave that checked as well. The main point that I want to point out on this settings panel are the checkout pages. It's important to make sure that all of your pages are properly set up here under each field. For example, the carts page, when I click on this, you want to make sure that it says cart. And checkout page, you want to make sure the checkout page is selected. Most of this will automatically be added when you install WooCommerce, but it's always a good idea to double check to make sure that the pages are set properly. If you'd like to add a terms and conditions page, you can create a page by going up to plus new, creating a page, calling it terms and conditions, and then here, once it has been created, you can click on this button here and you'll find your terms and conditions page. I haven't yet created a terms and conditions page, so I'm going to leave that blank, but that's the process you'd use in order to set up your terms and conditions. Then I'm just going to scroll to the bottom. Everything else looks good. Here's where we have our payment gateway, so this is really important. Before we move on though, I'm going to click on Save Changes to save my changes. Now, at the top, there's a number of links. Here are all the checkout options right here. You can pay by check, cash on delivery, PayPal, or Simplify Commerce, which is with credit cards. Here at the bottom, these are the same exact things. So our payment gateways refer to direct bank transfer, check payment, cash on delivery, PayPal, and credit cards. Now with PayPal, a customer could also use their credit card. So I'm going to set my shop up with PayPal. So at the top, you can just go one by one. I'm going to click on this one first, BACS. Here we see that it is not enabled because it's unchecked. That's good because I don't want to include this as a payment option. Then for checks, if you'd like to set up a checking payment option, you can do so by clicking on check, and then you would enable it by clicking on enable. I'm going to leave that unchecked. Cash on delivery is the same thing. Click on that. And then it's unchecked for me, which is good because I don't want to have cash on delivery. But here when I click on PayPal, this is the one that I want. So here we see that PayPal is enabled. That looks good. I'm going to go with all the defaults underneath for the title and description. And for the PayPal email, here you want to add your PayPal email. Then I'm just going to scroll to the bottom. I want to make sure my receiver email is correct. That looks good. And everything else looks good. So once you've changed anything or created changes, go ahead and save those changes by clicking on Save Changes. If you'd like to use Simplify Commerce, you can do so by clicking on Simplify Commerce. And here you can learn more about how to get started with Simplify Commerce by clicking on this button here to learn more or this button to sign up. I'm not going to use that system or that payment method. I'm simply going to use PayPal. Okay, once you have everything set up, make sure that you do save your changes down below. Then we'll move on to the shipping options. Here on shipping, we can see at the top, there's a number of different ways to ship your products: flat rate shipping, free shipping, international flat rate, local delivery, and local pickup. So I do want to enable shipping, so I'm going to make sure that is checked. I do not want to put the shipping calculator, so I'll leave that unchecked. Again, if you'd like to customize this for your needs, please, by all means, do so, and you can refer to the documentation about WooCommerce at woothemes.com. In this particular demo, I only want to include free shipping. So here we can see free shipping is enabled, and that looks great. So if you'd like to enable any of the other ones, flat rate shipping, for example, you would just go up to the top, click on flat rate, and then here you would click on enable the shipping method, and you would set up all of your different settings for flat rate shipping. I'm going to leave that unchecked because I don't want to use that for this demo. Instead, I want to use free shipping, so I'll click on free shipping. And here we can see free shipping is enabled. Great. So then you can just go through these others. It's the same exact thing. You enable them and then you set them up how you would like to set them up. Now going back to shipping options, this is a quick dashboard of our shipping options. When I scroll to the bottom, here we can see, as I want, free shipping is the only one of all of these that is enabled on my current demo online store. Awesome. Okay, so then I'm just going to scroll up to the top and click on accounts. As it notes at the top, these pages need to be set so that WooCommerce knows where to send users to access account-related functionality. One of the most important things at the top here is my account page. You want to make sure that it says my account right here for my account page. Then you can review all of these options. I'm going to leave all the defaults as they are, and then I'll just click on Save Changes to save my changes. Then for emails, I'm going to click on emails. These are the emails that are sent to your customer at various points in the purchase process. As it notes, the following options affect the sender used in WooCommerce emails. That would be you or me. So for example, for here, from name, I want this to have my name because my emails will be sent from me, and I want my email address because that will be sent from me as well. Then for the header image, you can enter a URL if you want to show that in the email header. I'm not going to use that. I'm just going to delete this altogether. Okay, for the email footer text, you can adjust that here as well. Once you've made your changes, go ahead and click on Save Changes to save your changes. Last but not least, here we have all these other email options. You can go through them one by one. These are all the various default emails that are sent to your customers at various points in the purchase process. Okay, so once we have all the WooCommerce settings set up, now we can move on to the fun part, which is adding products to our e-commerce WordPress online store. So before we add products to our WordPress website, let's take a look and see where we're headed. So here we are on the homepage. When I scroll down, we'll see there's all these featured products here. So this is where we're headed. We're going to be adding those now. And when I click on any one of these, for example, this one right here, we'll see here we have the a single product page featuring the product image, which when I click on this, it opens up into a really nice light box display so I can see the product better. And here on the right-hand side, we have the product title, the price, a short description, and an add to cart button. Also, we have these really cool share buttons here so anyone can share this product via social media. So cool. Then down below, we'll have the longer product description as well as some reviews. Okay, so this is where we're headed. Let's get started. Going back to our dashboard, I'm going to go down to products, hover over products, and click on add product. Also note, you can add a new product by going up to the top, hovering over plus new, and clicking on product here as well. So first up, we need to give our product a name. So I'm going to call this the Vegan Recipe Collection. And once we've given our product a title, then we can add the longer description here in the white box. Okay, once you've given the description of your product on the right-hand side, we can see there's lots of different product categories. So we can choose one that exists, or you can create a new category by clicking on Add New Category, then naming the category. Then you want to click on this button down below that says Add New Product Category to create the new category. Okay, once we have our product category set, then we can scroll down. And here we'll see the product data section for WooCommerce. So here we see that we're going to be creating a simple product now. However, when I click on this, you'll see there's all these other types of products you can create. A group product if you want to create a bundle, external affiliate product if you want to feature affiliate products, or a variable product. That would be something like if I had a variety of t-shirts or something, and one was blue and one was pink and one was yellow, then I would create a variable product. But for this particular product, I'm going to be creating a simple product because it's just, I only have one variation of this. There are no variations. So because there's no variations, this is just a simple product. So I'm going to give it a price. We'll say $40. And then we're good to go. So on the left, there's all these other options here for inventory, if you'd like to track inventory, shipping, if you want to feature special shipping. I'm going to be shipping via free shipping, so this doesn't pertain to me, but if you are featuring flat rate shipping or something else, you want to set up your shipping customizations in this box. If you'd like to link products, you can do so by clicking on link products to upsell or cross sell or group products. If you have questions about any of these things, you can click on this question mark here and it will give you a really cool tooltip that will explain exactly what this field is all about. There's also more documentation at woothemes.com. Okay, for variable products, this particular one is simple product, so it doesn't pertain, but if you do have a variable product, here you would set up your attributes right here. Last but not least, you have some advanced settings if you want to leave a note for customers who are interested in this product. So here, once again, it says enter an optional note to send the customer after purchase. Okay, so once you have all of the info set up the way you need it for the product. Again, this is a simple product and it's really simple. I'm just going to put the price and we're good to go. Then scrolling down, if you'd like to add some product tags, you can do so. I'm not going to be adding any product tags now, however. I will be creating a product image, of course. This is really important. So I'm going to click on Set Product Image. Then I'm going to click on Upload Files and select Files. Then I'll choose my file and click on open. And once the image has been uploaded, I want to give it a title as well as an alternative text. Then I'm going to click on set product image to set the product image. Okay, so once the product image has been set, next up I want to add a short description. So I'm just going to grab this first sentence to use as my short description. Then I'm going to scroll to the bottom here, and here where it says product short description, I'm just going to add that first sentence. Okay, so then we are pretty much good to go. I'm going to scroll up to the top and click on publish to publish my first product. So once the product has been published, then we can check it out by clicking on view product, and voila, here we see our product published on our online store in WordPress. So we have the product image, the product title, price, and short description, the add to cart button, and then we have these various email settings that we can share right here. So note that this one is for Facebook, looks like this is Twitter, this one is Google+, and this is email. If you'd like to adjust these, we can do so in the settings for short code. I'll go over that in just a few moments. Down below, we'll have our longer product description and then our reviews. So that is how you add a simple product to your WooCommerce WordPress website. So let's add one more product to our website. This time we'll add a variable product. So once again, to add a product, I'm gonna go up to the top, hover over plus new, and click on product. First up, we need to give our new product a product name. So I'll just call this vegan menu plan. Okay, then we wanna give our product a description. And once we've added the description on the right-hand side, we can choose a product category. This time, I'm going to add a new product category, so I'll just call this Menu Plans. Once you've added the product name, go ahead and scroll down and click on Add New Product Category. Okay, now on the left-hand side, this time, instead of creating a simple product, we're going to create a variable product. So when I click on this, I'm going to choose Variable Product. Now we'll see we have a different display for this type of product. So once again, you can set up your inventory here on the left-hand side, your shipping, your linked products. Then we have attributes and variations. So first up, I want to click on attributes. Here in the attributes panel, we can add a product attribute by clicking on add. In this case, because I'm creating menu plans, one attribute name may be the duration of the plan. So I'll just give this a name of duration. And the values may be something like a 7-day plan or a 14-day plan or a 30-day plan. So I'm going to add the attribute values separated by a pipe symbol right here. So for example, if you have a t-shirt, some attributes may be color or size. In that case, one attribute name may be size, so you'd put size right here. Then for the value, you'd put small and then a pipe symbol, medium and another pipe symbol, and then large. Or if you have a color, the color might be the attribute name right here, so you would put color. And for the values, you may put something like red, blue, and green. Now, of course, I'm not having any colors with my particular attributes, so I'm going to remove this, but I just wanted to show you how you would write that, making sure that you do separate each attribute value with a pipe symbol. Okay, so going back to my attribute here, I'm just gonna leave it as two values, 7-day and 14-day plans. Then on the left-hand side, I am going to make these visible on the product page, so that needs to be checked. And I am going to use these for variations, so I'm going to check that as well. Then I'm going to click on Save Attributes to save my attributes. Once attributes have been saved, now I can go down to Variations by clicking on Variations. Here on the Variable Product panel, I'm going to click on Add Variation and click on Go. Okay, so I have my first variation. Then I'm going to click on Expand. And now we can see all the other settings where we can uniquely define the various variations for this particular variation. So here at the top, I'm going to click on that right there. Here we see the 7-day one. So I'm going to click on 7-day and I'm going to give this a unique price. So maybe I'll say this will be $100. So there we go. And that's really the minimum that you need to add here within this variation panel. So I'm just going to scroll down. Of course, there's other details if you'd like to, again, specify shipping class for this particular variation or a sale price for this particular variation, but I'm going to keep it simple and just put, actually, I need to put it over here for the regular price, $100 for a week for this plan. That includes a lot of stuff. Okay, then I'll click on Save Changes to save the changes. Okay, so once we have that variation ready to go, we can do another variation for the 14-day plan, once again by clicking Go. Then up above, here where it says any duration, I'm going to click on that and click on the 14-day. Then I'm going to click on Expand to expand all my options. And here for the regular price, I'll make this $175. Okay, so now I have two different variations and two prices for pretty much the same product for a different time frame. Okay, then I'm going to scroll to the bottom and once again click on Save Changes to save my variations. Cool, so we're good to go. Now I'm just going to add a product image, so I'm going to click Set Product Image, then I'm going to upload a file and click on Select Files, then I'm going to choose my file and click on Open. And once the image has been uploaded to my WordPress website, I'm going to give the image a title as well as an alternative text. Then at the bottom, I'm going to click on Set Product Image to set the product image. Then I'm going to scroll up here and I'm going to grab once again that first sentence. highlight it and copy it. I'm going to scroll to the bottom, and here for the product short description, I'm going to add a short description down below in this box. Cool. So now I'm going to come up to the top and click on publish to publish my second product on the site, a variable product. Great, so let's take a look at this product by clicking on view product. So here on the product page, we see now we have some variations for this product because this is a variable product with a price range of $100 to $175. And here we can choose a duration by clicking on choose an option. We can choose a 7-day plan, and that will give us $100 right here. Or if we want the 14-day plan, we can choose that, and that is $175. Awesome. Then we just scroll to the bottom, and here is the longer product description. Also, there's some additional information now, so when I click on that, we see that this comes in two different versions, a 7-day or a 14-day plan. Awesome! So that's how you create a variable product within WooCommerce on your WordPress online store. So now that we've added a simple product as well as a variable product to our WooCommerce WordPress online store, I'm going to add a few more products behind the scenes, and I'll see you on the other side. I'm going to be following the exact same steps that I just showed you in the previous two examples. So I've just added more products to our WooCommerce WordPress online store, and here on the shop page, we can see all of them displayed. When I go to the home page, however, and scroll down to the featured products section, we'll find that there are no featured products being displayed. So next up, we need to add featured products to the home page so that when they're done, they will display here on the home page. To add featured products to the homepage, we want to go back up to the top and click on Dashboard. Then we want to go down to Products and click on Products. And then one by one, we want to hover over each individual product and click on Quick Edit. This will bring up a panel which, when we scroll down, we'll see there's this featured option right here. So I want to click on Featured and click on Update. Then I want to do the same thing for all the other products on the page so that 4 products are being displayed on the homepage. So I'll click on Quick Edit, then click on Featured and Update, and then 2 more times. Okay, so once every product has been set to Featured Product, now when I go to the homepage and click on Visit Site, now when I scroll down, I'll find that all my featured products are being displayed on the homepage. And when I click on any one of them, it will go to the individual product page where I can learn more about this particular product. So cool. Now note that there are no associated products down below. It's always a good idea to suggest alternate products that are similar to this one. And the reason those are not popping up is because we haven't added tags to our products. So let's do that now. Going up to the top, I'm going to click on Dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to Products and click on Products. Then once again for this top product, I'll click on Quick Edit. Then here on the Products page, I'm going to click on all of these by clicking on this X to check all of these products, and I'm going to apply a bulk action called Edit. Then I'll click on Apply. So here I want to add tags right in this box for all of these products. And for the sake of time, I'll just call this vegan, but of course you'd want to call your product something else, maybe breakfast or dinner, or if you have other products, whatever pertains to you, go ahead and add your product tags for a bundle of products. Then we can scroll to the bottom and click on Update. So now I want to go back to my site by clicking on Visit Site, and I scroll down to my featured products here and I click on one product. Now we'll see, in addition to the actual product page right here, we also have some related products being suggested down below. So cool. Okay, last but not least, let's take care of all these settings here for the sharing options. To do that, I'm going to go back up to Dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to Short Codes, which can be found under Appearance. So going down to Appearance, I'm going to hover over Appearance and then click on Short Codes. Now we've covered the social media short codes previously in the video, but now we have these share buttons right here. So I'm going to click on that. Here we can see that these are the ones that are being displayed on the product pages. So we have Facebook, Twitter, Google, and email. I'm not going to add Google, I'll remove that. So instead we'll just have Facebook, Twitter, and email. And if you'd like to customize the various titles here, you can do so by changing the share text. I'm going to leave Facebook with share, I'll leave Twitter as tweet, and then for email, I'll just call this email, which it already is, so we're good to go. Then I'll just scroll to the bottom and click on save changes to save the changes. So now we go back to the product page by going up to the top and clicking on visit site. and we scroll down to the product individual featured products here, and when I click on this, now we see that on the product page, now we have three share options: share to Facebook, tweet, and email. Awesome. Then we have our product description and our related products. So cool. So we're almost done creating this website. Last up, we need to add some blog posts to our website. For example, when we go to the blog archive page, currently we see that we have all of the blog filters and tags up above, as well as all of the blog posts that came with the XML file that we imported earlier in this video. So naturally, we need to swap all of these out with our own blog post. So to create a new blog post, I'm going to go up to the top, hover over the website name, and click on Dashboard. Then here on the dashboard, I'm going to go down to Post, hover over Post, and click on All Posts. Here on the post page, we can see all the blog posts that have been added to our website, and note that the author for most of these is admin. So those are all the ones that came with the XML file. So eventually we'll be deleting these all together, but for now I want to create a new post by going up to the top and clicking on Add New. Here on the Add New Post page, the first step is we need to give our new blog post a title. So I'm going to add my title here. And once a blog post has a title, next up we can add our content for the post here in this white box. Once you have the content in this white box, you can format it by using any one of these formatting icons. On the right-hand side, here we have the format of the blog post. I'm going to keep it as standard. Then I'm going to scroll down, and here where it says categories, I'm going to create a new category. Once you've added the new category name, you can actually create the category once again by clicking on Add New Category. Okay, there we have the new category. Great. Then I'm going to scroll down and give my new post some tags, and then I'll click Add. And then last but not least, here where it says Featured Image, I'm going to set the featured image by clicking on this link. Then I will upload in a file by making sure this is checked, upload, and then I'll select my file. Then here's my file at the top. I'm going to highlight it and select it and click on open. Once the image has been uploaded to the WordPress website, then we want to give our image a title as well as an alternative text. So I'll add that in here. And then when you're ready, go ahead and click on set featured image to set the featured image. Here on the left-hand side, you'll see an excerpt. It's always a good idea to create a short excerpt. So I'm just going to grab the first sentence of this content here, and then I'm going to scroll down and drop that here in the excerpt box. So we are good to go. Then when we scroll down, we see that comments are enabled because here we see discussion with these two boxes checked. Okay, once you have your content and your blog post set the way you like, go ahead and click on Publish to publish your new blog post. Once our blog post has been published, now we can check it out on the website by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Now when we click on Blog by clicking on Blog, here we'll see our new blog post showing up on our blog archive page in this really cool Pinterest style. We also see the new blog category filter that we created right here above. So in the essence of time, I'm going to create some more blog posts behind the scenes following the same steps that I used to create this blog post right here. So I'll see you on the other side once I've created a bunch of additional blog posts. So I've just finished adding a bunch of new blog posts to our website following the steps in the previous example. So now when we look at the blog archive page, we see all of our new blog categories and filters here at the top. And we see all of the images for our new blog posts here on the blog archive page. Jumping back to our homepage, if you made it this far, congratulations, because you should have an e-commerce WordPress website that looks something like this. Here at the top, we have our header section with our call to action, as well as our top menu, our logo, our tagline, our social media icons, and our primary menu. Then we have our image or slider. Then we have our various images down below, all of which go to an independent internal page within our website. Then we have our tagline or quote right here, our featured products, and at the bottom we have our customized footer section, which in this video we've added Instagram photos, an email opt-in form, and some quick links. Going back to the top of our homepage to check out the e-commerce features by clicking on Shop, here we'll see all the various products that are available within our online store. And when I click on any one of these, for example this one, then we'll go to the single product page where we'll have a featured image of the product title, price, and short description, an add to cart button, and then some social sharing buttons so potential customers and customers can share this product via social media or via email. Then down below, we'll have a longer product description, some reviews, and some related products. So this brings us to the end of this website tutorial. We've just finished creating this beautiful e-commerce WordPress website using the Meadowbrook theme by Angie Makes, which is available as part of a WordPress bundle at Creative Market. So I hope this video was helpful to you. If it was, feel free to drop me a comment below, like this video, and share this video with your friends. I will be coming out with more videos related to WordPress and building an online business. So please subscribe to my YouTube channel. Before we go, I want to give a quick shout out of thanks to Creative Market for sponsoring this video. I'm so thrilled to partner with Creative Market because not only do they provide a lot of really cool design resources for all of us who are creating our own website, but they also serve as a platform and marketplace for independent creators like you and me and many others around the world to sell digital products on their site. So thank you, Creative Market, and everyone who's watching, be sure to check them out at creativemarket.com. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, I hope you have a wonderful week and continue learning new skills that help you to build your business on the web.